Good morning.
Good morning.
It's good to see everybody here this morning that was able to make it. I'm sure, as probably most of you saw, pray for a couple of the families that aren't here this morning. Few are sick and under the weather, a few are traveling. So please keep each of them in your prayers. But looking forward to worshiping together this morning. And of course, we have the meal afterwards. So if you're able to stay, please do, because we've got how many pounds of chicken?
25 pounds
of chicken. So hopefully everybody has brought their appetite this morning.
Nate, this is for you.
A couple of announcements to make here. Women's Bible study, is that still happening tomorrow night? Okay, so tomorrow night, Women's Bible study, that will be at our house, and that will be at 6:30 p.m. And then this coming Wednesday night, April 19th, is going to be our prayer meeting and Bible study, but we are starting a new series on the book of Daniel. So encourage you to come out to that. Invite others out if you're able to. Next Sunday, April 23rd, will be a membership day. And so we will be taking in new members that morning. And then also on that morning, very excited to announce that Nate will be taken in as a deacon as well. So looking forward to that. If you're able to be here for it, what we'll basically do after we take in the members, we'll then appoint Nate into that position and just have a time of prayer for him as well. So very thankful for his willingness to serve in that capacity. Then Thursday, April 27th, will be our next men's Bible study at 6:30 p.m. here at the church. Hopefully, we actually make it to that one, because I think we've had to cancel the task three for various reasons. And then Friday, April 28th, will be our next family game night here at the church. That will be at 6:30 p.m. Bring a covered dish to share. Invite others out. We don't yet have a theme for it, but if we come up with one, I will let you know soon.
It's gonna be chicken.
What's that?
It's going to be chicken.
It might just be a chicken theme. That's right. I have a quote here at the bottom of the bulletin from Robert Louis Dabney, which goes along with the sermon, but I won't be using the quote in the sermon, so I'm just going to read it now. He wrote, "Why dwelleth the divine mind, that's God's mind, in an ineffable, perpetual peace? Not because there are none to assail it, but because God is conscious in himself of infinite resources for defense and victory, of a knowledge which no cunning can deceive, of a power which no combination can fatigue. Well, these same attributes which support the stability of Jehovah's throne surround the weakest child of God with all the zeal of redeeming love." In other words, the peace that God experiences despite the many people that attack him and come against him is the same peace that is ours as Christians through our knowledge of the living God. So let's go ahead and go to the Lord this morning in prayer. Father, as we come before you today, we thank you for your blessings over us. We thank you, Lord, that you give us peace, a peace that far surpasses all understanding. And Lord, we thank you also that you're with us every step of the day, every place that we go. And Lord, so we pray now this morning for those who are sick and under the weather, unable to be with us. We pray, Lord, for healing over them. For those this morning, Lord, who are recovering, we pray that you would continue to heal them. And for those who are traveling, Lord, be with them. But for those who are here with us this morning, Lord, we pray that you would bless us and encourage us. And those who are going to be listening online as well, who want to be here but can't, bless them and encourage them as well, Lord, through the songs that are sung, through the prayers that are prayed, through the scriptures that are read, through the word that is proclaimed and preached. We pray, Lord, that you would be with us, accomplish your perfect plan, will, and purposes, and get the glory, honor, and praise that you alone deserve. For it's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.
The call to worship this morning is taken out of Acts chapter 4, verse 12. It says, "And there is salvation in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given among men by which we must be saved." Stand with me this morning, turn to page 164. I know we're small in number, so everybody's going to have to pull extra duty this morning as far as singing goes, because I hope my voice will hold out. You know, none of us have ever had a friend like Jesus. He's the friend that sticketh closer than any brother ever could and will never leave us. Sing with me this morning, "What a Friend We Have in Jesus."
What a friend we have in Jesus. All I to carry everything to God in prayer. Oh, what peace we often forfeit. Oh, what needless pain we bear. All because we do not carry everything to God in prayer. Trouble anywhere. We should never be discouraged. Take it to the Lord in prayer. And we find a friend so faithful. With the load of care, precious Savior, still our refuge, take it to the Lord in prayer. Do thy friends despise, forsake thee? We'll find a soulless day.
Amen. Aren't you glad you have a friend in Jesus?
Amen.
Turn back to page 391. I've been wanting to learn this one for a while. Actually, Jake, the one that brought it to my attention, like most of the ones that are difficult to learn and sing. No, it's a really good song, though. It's a cry, you know, for sinners to come to Christ. And you know, the song is a little different, but Matthew 11, Jesus says, "Come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest." You know, no matter what setting we're in, whether it be Sunday morning worship service, you know, one of the Bible studies, or even a game night, you know, we as children of God have a duty to share the gospel in every aspect of our lives, whether we're apart or whether we're together. So I'll sing along with the song. It's a little different. But we should be able to learn it pretty quick. It's "Come Ye Sinners, Poor and Needy."
Come ye sinners, poor and needy, weak and wounded, sick and sore. Jesus ready stands to save you, full of pity, love and power. I will arise and go to Jesus. He will embrace me in his arms, in the arms of my dear Savior. Oh, there are 10,000 charms. Come ye thirsty, come and welcome God's free bounty, glorified, true belief and true there are 10,000 charms. Come ye weary, heavy laden, lost and ruined by the fall. If you tarry till you're better, you will never come at all. I will arise and go to Jesus. He will embrace me in his arms, in the arms of my dear Savior. Oh, there are 10,000 charms.
Now, verse 4.
Lord incarnate, God ascended, cleansed the merit of his blood. Venture on him, venture holy, let no other trust in truth. I will arise and go to Jesus. He will embrace me in his arms, in the arms of my dear Savior. Oh, there are 10,000 charms.
The chorus one more time.
I will arise and go to Jesus. He will embrace me in his arms, in the arms of my dear Savior. Oh, there are 10,000 charms.
Amen. That sounded pretty good. You may be seated this morning. Our scripture reading, I believe, is by Nick this morning.
I'll be reading Jonah chapter 4 this morning. But it displeased Jonah exceedingly, and he was angry. And he prayed to the Lord and said, O Lord, is not this what I said when I was yet in my country? That is why I made haste to flee to Tarshish. For I knew that you are a gracious God and merciful, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love, and relenting from disaster. Therefore now, O Lord, please take my life from me, for it's better for me to die than to live. And the Lord said, do you do well to be angry? Jonah went out of the city and sat at the east of the city and made a booth for himself there. He sat under it in the shade till he should see what would come of the city. Now the Lord God appointed a plant and made it come up over Jonah that it might be a shade over his head to save him from the discomfort. So Jonah was exceedingly glad because of the plant. But when dawn came up the next day, God appointed a worm that attacked the plant so that it withered. When the sun rose, God appointed a scorching east wind, and the sun beat down on the head of Jonah, so that he was faint. And he asked that he might die and said, it is better for me to die than to live. But God said to Jonah, Do you do well to be angry for the plant? And he said, yes, I do well to be angry, angry enough to die. And the Lord said, you pity the plant for which you did not labor, nor did you make it grow, which came into being in a night and perished in the night. And should not I pity Nineveh, that great city in which there are more than 120,000 persons who do not know their right hand from their left, and also much cattle?
Amen. One of the things that I think we encounter with the story of Jonah that's amazing is when he says, I believe it's in verse number 3, he's angry because he knows that the Lord is abounding in steadfast love and merciful and gracious to all who call upon him. And you look at that and you go, why would you be angry about this? And the answer is because Jonah didn't want the Ninevites to be saved. He didn't want them to come to salvation in the Lord. And I think it's a check for us. Because if we're honest, sometimes there are people in the world that either we look at and we say they're beyond salvation, or we look at them and we say, I really don't want them to receive the steadfast love and graciousness and mercy of the Lord, which abounds forever and ever. But Jonah's story is a story that checks us in our own sinfulness and reveals to us that because God is merciful, we are saved. And because we have been shown mercy, our great desire should be to see mercy shown now to others. So praise the Lord for the book of Jonah and for all the truths that are revealed within it. That brings us to the end of Jonah, obviously. And so we will begin a new book next Sunday, reading through together as a congregation. But at this point, we're going to make it prayer time in this morning's service. So if you have any prayers or praises, please share them. I'll go ahead and mention one. As many of you know, we have been discussing the possibility of another church building. Nothing definite, nothing solid. I won't go into great detail because we've got the live stream, but those who are on the live stream probably also know what I'm talking about. But just in case, so that we don't spread any rumors or anything like that, we are looking at another building. In fact, that church is meeting today to discuss possibilities. So if you would, pray for that. Pray that it would, if it's the Lord's will, that it's something that would work out well for all parties involved, and that it would, of course, be something that we could reasonably afford, because the last thing that we want to do is just strap ourselves down and, you know, end up wrecking the church with something that we can't afford. So clearly we don't want to do that. So this isn't a guaranteed thing. There's a lot of variables right now, a lot of things that need to be figured out. But if you would, pray for it. And if it's the Lord's will, it's the Lord's will. And if not, we will praise him either way. So that's the big prayer for the church this morning. Plus, continue to pray for all those who are sick. Pray also, I saw in the messages, I believe Shane and Chase said they were traveling, I think is what they said. So let's pray for them with safe traveling mercies. And continue to lift up one another in prayer as well, because I know there are some here this morning who are recovering from illness, but continue to pray for each other. Anything else this morning? Go ahead.
I have a neighbor girl whose mother was recently diagnosed with cancer, and just pray for that situation there.
Amen.
Spiritually as well as physically.
I know that a while back Andrew did a prayer for his Aunt Teresa. This is a praise. She is doing better. She's off the fence. She Amen. Is going to be going to rehab. So it looks like she's going to be okay.
Amen. And this is Teresa.
Teresa, yeah.
Yes. Let's continue to remember her in our prayers this morning. Anybody else?
Just if you remember, pray for both my sisters, actually. One is a bit of a wayward child. I guess pray for her and pray for my other sister and my brother-in-law as they have some decisions to make as to where they reside and work and things.
Amen. Let's remember Nate's family in our prayers. Anybody else? I think if you would, continue to pray for the evangelism day that we had. I know that we handed out many tracts that day. We shared the gospel with many people. We even had the chance to invite some people to the church. And I know that we're not necessarily seeing fruit from that personally, but it could be people have actually read and have listened to what we've said and are considering the gospel. So praying that that would bear fruit in their lives. It doesn't have to be this week. It doesn't have to be tomorrow. It doesn't have to be a month from now. But the Lord can certainly use those seeds that were planted to lead people to Christ. So let's pray that the Lord would do that. Let's also continue to pray for our church body, that the Lord would lead some here to hear the gospel, and that he would also prepare us for our next evangelism day, which we're looking at now for May. So just keep that in mind. We don't have a specific date or location plan just yet, but we are looking forward to doing that again. Anybody else this morning?
For our youth.
Amen.
Lorelai has made her mission at school to minister to her friends that are on the butter bench. And this week she met a few children that were hesitant, and she's having a hard time understanding how anyone could be so negative and just go against Jesus. Not just for her, but for the youth that they continue to share, and they don't fall into that trap.
Amen. We do often pray for the youth of our church and youthful Christians, but I think one of the things we do neglect to pray for sometimes are the young people all over this country that don't know Christ, that are in households that actually reject Jesus, and they do so in very harsh and negative ways. And so let's pray for them, because we know that God is able to reach even those kids and even those parents as well. In the midst of all of those trials, the Lord is able to save souls. Anybody else this morning? I do have one other prayer request. If you think to pray for me tonight, actually, I forgot what time I'm doing it. I think it's 7 o'clock, 8 o'clock. I don't know. Tonight at some point, I better figure that out. I'm doing another one of the teaching series on the 1689 Confession online. The last one I did was back early February, and so this actually brings the confession to a conclusion. I'm not sure what to expect as far as number of people are concerned or anything like that. All I know is that I'm talking about the end of everything. So I'm talking about the death of Christians, what happens to us when we die, that sort of intermediate state where we go to be with the Lord in spirit, and then how we then are physically resurrected when Christ returns to the world and he judges everything. So actually, one of my favorite subjects to teach on. It's one of my favorite parts of the confession. But still, pray for me that even though the people who are going to be on there are Christians, as far as we can tell, you know, they profess to be Christians, pray nonetheless that I would be faithful to declare the gospel and that I would explain God's word clearly, succinctly, and in such a way that they would be drawn into a deeper faith. And not in the confession is just a helpful tool, that they would be drawn to a deeper faith, a clearer faith in the word of God itself. Anybody else this morning? I have unspoken needs this morning. I pray his answer those. Lord knows each and every one of them. Let's go ahead and get a hold of the Lord in prayer together. Father, as we come before you this morning, we thank you once more for your many blessings over us. We thank you, O Lord, that you are God, that you are sovereignly enthroned in heaven, reigning over absolutely everything. And we thank you, Lord, that there is not even one maverick molecule in this universe. For Lord, you are in control over everything. Everything seen, everything unseen, you are sovereign, reigning, ruling over it all. And so as we come before you this morning, Lord, with our petitions, with our supplications, with our prayers, we know that you are able to meet our needs according to your riches and glory, because you truly are the sovereign God who reigns and rules over all. And so this morning, Lord, we pray for Nina's neighbor with the cancer, and we pray, Lord, that you would provide not only strength and healing, but that you would meet the spiritual needs that are represented there as well. We pray, Lord, for all of those who are battling cancer, that not only would you heal them, but that those who don't know you would be drawn to you, and those who do know you would be led to a deeper and greater faith within you. We pray also, Lord, for Lorelai with the situation at school. We thank you, Lord, that she has been, that she has upon her heart a desire to go and to reach these children who don't know you. And Lord, we pray that you would give her the boldness, the faithfulness, even the wisdom, Lord, and the courage that she needs, and the love to continue to sharing with these young people. But Lord, we do pray for these kids as well. It's so sad to hear of those who don't believe in God, who don't believe in Christ, who believe in Satan more than they believe in the Lord, who who believe in all of these wicked and twisted fantasies and deceptions. Lord, we know that you alone are able to lead these young people and their families to you. And so, Lord, we pray that you would do just that. We do pray also this morning for Nate's sisters and their families and all of the situations represented there, one with being wayward, the other, Lord, with trying to determine where to go and what to do. Lord, we pray that you would lead them into greater clarity and wisdom and understanding of you, primarily, first of all, that they then would be led into a clear direction of where it is they should go and what it is that they should do. Lord, we do pray this morning for all of those who are sick, all of those who are unable to be here. I'm sure some are watching online right now, and we pray that you would minister to them. And though they are watching from afar, we, Lord, long to see them gathered with us again. And so we pray that you would heal them, that you would heal their bodies, and that you would help them to join our fellowship and our gathering here to worship together as the body of Christ. Lord, I do pray for those who are here this morning, that you would give us health and strength, that you would keep us from the various afflictions that are all around. And yet, Lord, even as we pray for healing and even as we pray for health and strength, we know that death is a reality, or we'll have to approach if the Lord should tarry. And so we pray for this one that John mentioned who perhaps was killed in some sort of accident, whatever the case may be. We pray that you would be with those who were involved in that accident, that you would provide strength and healing, encouragement, and again, that you would use it as an opportunity to lead lost sinners to salvation. Lord, we do pray also that you would continue to use our church to spread the gospel and to reach the lost and to see souls saved, not in our own strength or power, but Lord, by the power of your word and through the Holy Spirit that is at work within each of us who have professed Jesus as our Lord and Savior. We pray that you would bless our church. We know that there is some decisions perhaps even being made today about a potential building for us to begin meeting in. And if it's your will for us to go and meet there, then we pray that you would not only blow the doors wide open for us, but that you would make it clear beyond all shadow of a doubt that that is where we are to go. If you would have us to stay here, make that clear. If there's another place that you would have us to go, make that clear. We only pray, Lord, that we would be within your will and that we would make decisions that are honorable, that would glorify you, and that would make the best use of the time, for we know the days are evil. So we pray that we would redeem the time, not only as a church, but as individuals and within our families as well. Redeem the time, Lord, within our lives, and help all that we say and do to bring you glory, honor, and praise as we lift even these unspoken needs to you in prayer, and as we trust that you will meet them according to your riches and glory. We pray again that you get the glory and you alone. For it's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. Amen.
Stand with me again this morning. Turn to page 162. I know I'm throwing in another new song, but I really like the words of this hymn. The first verse goes, "Wonderful, merciful Savior, precious Redeemer and friend, who would have thought that a lamb could rescue the souls of man?" You know, and that's exactly what he was sent here to do. I heard a preacher somebody who calls himself a preacher this week say that Christ never actually reached his full potential while here on earth. That, you know, because he died when he was only 33, that he had so much more he could have done. Well, that, you know, that's a dangerous statement to make, because Christ did exactly what he was supposed to do when he came here. Colossians 1, verses 15 to 16 says, "He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation. For by him all things were created in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities. All things were created through him and for him." You know, Christ did accomplish everything that he was supposed to. There is no maybe, there is no what if in God's kingdom or God's plan. Everything that has happened, ever will happen, has been perfectly set up by God himself. You know, there is nothing that he does not control. He is sovereign. Sing with me this morning, "Wonderful, merciful Savior."
Wonderful, merciful Savior, precious Redeemer and friend, who would have thought that a lamb could rescue the souls of men?
verse 2. Counselor, Comforter, Keeper, Spirit, we long to embrace. You offer hope when our hearts have hopelessly lost the way. Oh, we hopelessly lost the way. Chorus. You are the one that we praise. You are the one we adore. You give the healing and grace our hearts always hunger for. Oh, our hearts always hunger for. Almighty, infinite Father, faithfully loving your own. Here in our weakness you find us, falling before your throne. Oh, we're falling before your throne. You are the one that we praise. You are the one we adore. You give the healing and grace our hearts always hunger for. Oh, our hearts always hunger for.
Sing that chorus one more time.
You are the one that we praise. You are the one we adore. You give the healing and grace our hearts always hunger for. Oh, our hearts always hunger.
He is a wonderful, merciful Savior.
Amen.
Turn over to page 407. Because of who He is and what He has and will do, we can sing songs like this one, one of the greatest hymns, "It Is Well With My Soul." You know, I don't know if anybody knows the story, so I'll just try to do a quick summary of it. So there was a businessman named Horatio Spafford. God had allowed him to be very successful. His wife and four daughters were headed to Europe, and he was actually going to follow a few days later because he had some business that he had to finish taking care of. Out at sea, the ship that his family was on actually collided with another ship and ended up ultimately sinking, and over 250-some people ended up dying from that sinking, including his four daughters. His wife, however, was rescued and made it back to Europe. So a few days or weeks later, when Horatio was on his way over to meet his wife, the ship that he was on passed over the spot where his daughters had went down, and the captain of the ship said, "This is, you know, where the accident happened." And it was at that moment that he started to pen the words to this powerful hymn: "When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot thou hast taught me to say, it is well. It is well with my soul." You know, as we prepare for the message this morning, my hope, and I know Pastor Jake's hope this morning, is that it is well with all of our souls this morning. And if it's not, it can be. Sing with me this morning, "It Is Well."
When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot thou hast taught me to say, it is well, it is well. Oh,
Though trials should come, let this blessed assurance control that Christ has regarded my helpless estate and has shed His own blood for my soul. It is well with my soul. It is well. Is nailed to the cross, and I bear it no more. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, O my soul. It is well with my soul. It is well, it is well with my soul. I like this last verse. And Lord, haste the day when the faith shall be sighed. The clouds be rolled back as a scroll.
Amen. If you have your Bibles this morning, take them and open them, please, to Matthew chapter 8. Matthew chapter 8. We're back into Matthew's gospel account this morning, and we're going to be looking at only a few verses at a story that I think many of us will be familiar with. Matthew chapter 8, verses 23 to 27. And within this text, we see Jesus calming a storm. And as we look at it, I'm sure that you're familiar with it, but there's a question that is asked in verse 27. Now, depending on your translation, it's phrased various ways, but I've used that question for the title of the sermon this morning, which is simply this: what manner of man is this? What manner of man is this? As we read this text, we're seeking to answer the question this morning: what manner of man is Jesus? So if you're there in Matthew chapter 8, and if you're able, please stand with me once more for the reverence of the reading of God's word. Matthew 8, beginning with the 23rd verse, the word of the Lord reads, "And when he," and that's Jesus, "and when he got into the boat, his disciples followed him. And behold, there arose a great storm on the sea, so that the boat was being swamped by the waves, but he was asleep. And they went and woke him, saying, 'Save us, O Lord, we are perishing.' And he said to them, 'Why are you afraid, O you of little faith?' Then he rose and rebuked the winds and the sea, and there was a great calm. And the men marveled, saying, "What sort of man is this that even winds and sea obey?" Ascends this reading of the holy, inspired, inerrant, infallible word of the living God. Receive it as such, and let's pray once more together. Father, as we come before you this morning, we thank you that within this text we find that you are sovereign over winds, waves, the sea, sea creatures, over the hearts of men, over the schemes of men, over the plans of men. There is not one thing over which you do not sovereignly reign. And so we can come before you confidently with our prayer that, Lord, you would be our shepherd, ever leading us, ever guiding us through this life. As we look to the disciples and as we see the fear that they experience within this text, we recognize that same fear sometimes, in fact, often, is present within us when we don't know where we're being led. Often, the church is just like the disciples on that boat, and we are being shaken by storms and trials and tribulations. But we know that you, Lord Jesus, are the captain of this ship, and that where you steer us is right and good, even if it's not always smooth sailing, even if sometimes it gets a little bit bumpy, even if the clouds overhead seem to envelop the sun and everything darkens around us, yet we know that you are our God. And so, Lord, I pray this morning, if there's one who doesn't know that, that today would be the day where they would come to a crystal clear reality that Jesus Christ alone is the Savior of sinners, and that they would repent of their sins and trust in him. And Lord, for those who do know you in that way, I pray that you would speak to us through the sermon, through this text, that we would see your power as it is on display. And as we see your power on display, we would draw confidence, hope, and courage as our hearts are soothed and calmed by the balm that you have given us here in your word today. So, Lord, hide me behind your cross. Make these words yours, not mine, and accomplish your perfect plan, will, and purposes, for it's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. Now, if I had to take a wild guess, I would say probably if you go out today and you talk to people who don't even attend church and you ask them to tell you some stories about Jesus, stories that they've heard, this would probably be one of them. This is a very popular story within Scripture. Now, I think there's probably a few reasons for that. One of them is that this story is actually often confused with the story of Jesus calming the sea when he walks on the water. And then remember, he invites Peter out, and Peter comes out, and then he begins to cry out, "Lord, I'm drowning, help me," and Jesus picks him back up. Two different accounts. So Jesus calms the sea on more than one occasion. But here, he's not outside of the boat, walking on water, coming to the disciples at night. Here, he is sleeping on the boat with them. Now, I think another reason why people like this story is because, for whatever reason, we like stories about the ocean. We like stories about the sea. We like stories about sailing. I don't think it's a mistake that one of the most popular books ever written was the book Moby Dick. And if you ever actually read Moby Dick, probably nobody here has ever actually read the whole thing. There are giant sections in that book on whaling. And it's literally just about whaling. It's actually used, after the book is written, as an instruction manual for whalers. And you ask, why do people like it? People like the water. People like hearing about the ocean. They like hearing about sailing. There's something about the adventure of it that just seems to attract our attention, that draws our imagination to it. Over the past 20 years, I think I read one of the most successful movie franchises is Pirates of the Caribbean. People like movies about pirates and seafaring adventures and all of those things. Don't even get me started on SpongeBob SquarePants, right? So people like the ocean. I think people like this story for that same reason. But there's a whole other element and dynamic here that's incredibly important. Deep down, every single one of us who are Christians, and even those who are not to some extent, want to know that there is a God who holds everything in his hands, and who is able to go to something that just seems so vast, so untamable, and he is able to have control over it. We want to know that there is a God who is actually omnipotent, that he is truly all-powerful. Not only that, but that he cares for us, that he cares for little old me and you. And that's exactly what we have within this account. A God who can control the seas and who personally, lovingly cares for his people. So for all those reasons, and I can list more, people are attracted to this story. But what I love about it is verse 27. After the disciples see the miracle, the calming of the sea, in verse 27, they marvel and they say, and notice, Jesus is still there. They're just so amazed. They have to say it. What sort of man is this that even winds and sea obey? Or I believe as the King James puts it, or another translation, what manner of man is this? What manner of man is he? Well, remember, we have the benefit of being on the other side of the cross. We know the story of his death, burial, and resurrection. We can answer the question. He's the God-man. And so that's what we're going to work to. That's actually the fifth point. I'm giving it to you up front. Jesus is the God-man. But we're not going to get there unless we follow along with the disciples what's happening. Because as we go through this, verse by verse, we learn four other things about Jesus in each of the verses. We learn that Jesus is the leader. He is the one that we ought to follow. We learn that he is the king who depends upon his heavenly Father. We find that he is the savior of those who are perishing. We find out that he calms seas and hearts alike. And all of that then points us to this undeniable, amazing, joyful truth that Jesus is the God-man. But let's take this step by step and let's answer that question posed in verse number 27. What manner of man is this? Number one, we see Jesus is the man to follow. Jesus is the man to follow. Now, if you're following on the back of your bulletin in the sermon notes section, you're writing that down. I didn't know how to italicize the Jesus is the man to follow, but that's supposed to be italicized because I want you to see that he is not one amongst many other men that you might choose to follow. He is not one of many other options. He's not one leader amongst many or one savior amongst many. He is the only one to follow who will save sinners. So look again at verse 23. When he got into the boat, his disciples followed him. Now you might say, Jake, why are you pausing there? There's more to it. What can you really draw from that verse? A lot. Pause and look at it again. He got into the boat and they followed. This comes fresh on the heels of verses 18 through 22, where Jesus has actually just turned men away from following him by simply telling them that there's a cost to follow Christ. Remember, we saw, and this was a few weeks back, but we saw within that text that when you follow Jesus, you are surrendering your earthly comforts and privileges to him. You're giving it to him and saying, Lord, my life is yours. You're giving him your earthly possessions. You're saying, Lord, you're Lord of that as well. And you're even surrendering your life. You're saying, Lord, you're going to have all of me. You're not going to have just a piece of my life. I'm not going to compartmentalize things so that you get a piece here, but I'm going to hold on to this. Oh, no. When you come to Christ as your Savior and Lord, you bring all things under the Lordship of Jesus. So there is a cost to following him. But the beauty of it is, you gain Christ. And he is worth the loss of all of those other things that you might just have Jesus. Well, as they get into the boat, they find the proof of this. That when you follow Jesus, your life is not going to be devoid of problems. In fact, in many ways, you're going to have new problems you never had before following Jesus. But you'll have Christ. And that makes it all worth it. As Jesus said in John 16:33, I have said these things to you that in me you may have peace. In the world you will have tribulation, But take heart, I have overcome the world. See, Jesus wants us to know you're going to have tribulation as a Christian. This picture of the boat being tossed about upon the sea, famously, over many centuries, has commonly been thought to be a picture of the church. How often, though we are within the church, it's as though we are on a boat and we're being tossed around all over the place. We have three main enemies: the world, the flesh, our own flesh, and the devil. And all of them are just railing against us, trying to get the boat to capsize. But through it all, Jesus is our captain. And not only can he calm the storm, but there's a purpose for these things. It teaches us a greater faith in him. It teaches us over and over that he is the one to follow. So again, he's not one among many other gods. He's the only God. You can look at any other supposed God that has existed in this world. They're all dead, or they never existed to begin with, or they were demonic, but they were not God. Muhammad, dead. Buddha, dead. Gandhi, dead. JFK, dead. Doesn't matter who you're looking to as your God, all of them are dead. But Jesus Christ of Nazareth is alive and well. And this is why the disciples would then say in Acts 4:12, neither is there salvation in any other, for there is no other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. He alone is the Savior of sinners. And you must follow him, no matter where he leads. Even if he leads you through the valley of the shadow of death itself. Because when you follow this leader, when you follow Christ, what you will find is that even there, even in that valley, he is with you. And you can look to him and find comfort in him. Kayla and I were just talking about this last night. She pointed out that within Psalm 23, when they're in the valley of the shadow of death, God is there, and it's like that little sheep, that poor defenseless sheep that can't do anything for itself, looks up and sees the good shepherd and knows this good shepherd's going to fight off any bear, any lion that comes my way. He will protect and defend me no matter what. It's like our children. Josiah sometimes wakes up in the middle of the night and is afraid. Last night, I think he was really afraid because he didn't know the dog was lying in the hallway and slammed into the ground at like midnight and ran into the room and came and told me, Dad, I didn't know Silas was there. And it's fine. And he gets into bed next to Kayla and immediately, just like that, it's better. No problem anymore. Why? Because he's in the presence of those whom he knows he can trust. He knows that we love him and we will care for him and we will protect him. And so it is with us and God. No matter where he leads, we will follow. And where we follow him, he is with us. And there is a great comfort to draw from that. One of my favorite stories about this comes from a man named Polycarp, which I've talked about many times before. But Polycarp was an early Christian. So first generation of Christians after Jesus had resurrected and ascended into heaven. First generation of Christians after the apostles. In fact, it's believed that Polycarp learned from the Apostle John himself. And he was the bishop of the church of Smyrna. And his name originally was not Polycarp. It's believed that his name is taken from the Greek of John 15. Because in John 15, when Jesus talks about bearing much fruit, there are two Greek terms there that if you sort of just smush them together into a word or a name, it becomes Polycarp. So his name literally means bearer of much fruit. And this is how people knew him. He was faithful to the Lord, faithful to preach in a day when faithful preaching could get you killed. That's exactly what happened. At 86 years old, Roman authorities broke into Polycarp's home and they demanded that he come with them. But first, because he's an old man and they feel bad for him, they give him a chance. They say, Polycarp, just stop preaching about Jesus and come. You can stay. You don't even have to come. And he says, no, bring me. So they bring him to one of the Roman Colosseums. And it's there. Many Christians have been killed. You know the stories. Christians were used as human torches. They were lit on fire and they lit the festivities. Some Christians were burned alive at the stake. They were made to fight gladiators. They were made to fight lions and bears and other wild beasts and animals, all for the sport and amusement of the Romans. And here you have an 86-year-old man brought into that Colosseum, and they call on him once more. They say, Polycarp, tell us, away with the atheists. Because they called Christians atheists. They said, Christians only believe in one God, but we've got a pantheon of gods, and we worship Caesar. So the Christians are atheists. They deny our God. Polycarp looks, and he says, you want me to say away with the atheists? And he says, okay. And he points at the Romans, and he says, away with you, atheists. Well, that only angers the crowd. And so they say, Polycarp, here's your last chance. Deny Christ, or we will set you ablaze right now. Polycarp famously looks, and he says, 86 years have I served him, and he has done me no wrong. How can I blaspheme my king and my savior? It's done. They take Polycarp, they tie him up to a stake, they set him on fire, and in a most brutal way, he doesn't die. He burns, but he will not die. And so finally, to end the suffering, a man goes over and stabs him through the chest or the stomach, and he finally bleeds out and finally dies. It is a brutal, awful death. And you hear his words, 86 years have I faithfully served him, and he has done me no wrong. How could I now deny my king and my God? You look at that and you go, why did Jesus allow that to happen then? Well, here's what the story goes on to say. Despite the immense pain, torment, and suffering, Polycarp died as a man with immense peace. Although it was clearly an agonizing death, he didn't look like he was in agony. Although it was clearly a brutally painful death, he looked like he was in no pain at all. He died peacefully. And that's because, though Jesus led him into this terrible death, Jesus was with him. And Jesus used this, by the way, to have much fruit abound for the kingdom of God. His name, Polycarp, was fulfilled. Think of it, some came to faith that day when they saw the way he died. And even today, we still, almost 2,000 years later, are talking about this man. Because he was faithful to God and he knew the peace that comes through knowing Christ, even when he leads us through the valley of the shadow of death itself. Now, why is he the leader to follow? Well, it's because number two, Jesus is the king who trusts in God and is unmoved by trials. He is the king who trusts in God and is unmoved by trials. Verse number 24. Behold, there arose a great storm on the sea, so that the boat was being swamped by the waves. But he was asleep. Now, it's almost as though the immediacy of the storm proves that following Jesus won't always be easy. And as this storm arises, you see the disciples, and they're fearful, but not Jesus. Jesus is there in the boat, and we read, he's asleep. Now, think about this for a second. Rain is just pattering down on this old wooden boat. The waves are swamping it, which means things are not only rocky, not only are things moving all over the place, but water is actually filling the boat. So things are wet, it's loud. Thunder and lightning are cracking the sky overhead, and the disciples are probably by this point screaming like madmen trying to figure out what to do. And there in the midst is Jesus, and he's asleep. You ask, why is he asleep? Well, in part because he's fully human and he needs rest, he needs to sleep. But in another sense, he can sleep because he has perfect confidence and trust in his heavenly Father. So, he is sovereign, that's true, and so he doesn't have any need to worry about the storm. But remember, though he is sovereign, though he is God, he is truly man. He has actually become a human being. So he's not depending on his own power, he's depending upon the power of the Heavenly Father and the Holy Spirit. And it's in that faith and confidence that he rests. He rests as he is on the boat, despite all of the trials that surround him. Now, those who know their Old Testament know that him resting through this storm actually points us to the fact that he is the true and everlasting king. In 2 Samuel chapter 7, David was promised that there would be a descendant who would sit on his throne forever. At first, it looks like maybe it will be Solomon, but it becomes clear Solomon's not the guy. He falls into terrible sin. Jesus, however, is the man. He is the king that was promised. And what we see him doing here is actually fulfilling Psalm 3. Psalm 3. In Psalm 3, this is what we read. David is praying here. He is fleeing his son Absalom, and he writes, "O Lord, how many are my foes? Many are rising against me. Many are saying of my soul, there is no salvation for him in God. But you, O Lord, are a shield about me, my glory and the lifter of my head. I cried aloud to the Lord, and he answered me from his holy hill. I lay down and slept. I woke again, for the Lord sustained me. So I will not be afraid of many thousands of people who have set themselves against me all around. Arise, O Lord, save me, O my God, for you strike all my enemies on the cheek. You break the teeth of the wicked. Salvation belongs to the Lord. Your blessing be on your people." One of the defining marks of the king who would truly and ultimately trust in God was the ability to have peace in the midst of storms. The ability to sleep despite hostility all around. Again, David wrote in Psalm 4:8, "In peace I will both lie down and sleep. For you alone, O Lord, make me dwell in safety." Because Jesus perfectly trusted in the Lord, he had perfect peace despite the trials, and he could rest and he could sleep. Now that same peace that Jesus displays is the same peace that he gives to us when we come before him in faith. He says, "My peace I leave you, my peace I give to you, not as the world gives, give I unto you." This is a supernatural peace. This is a peace that far surpasses all understanding, and it's a peace that can only come through knowing Christ and being known by him. I remember a couple years ago, we were going through a hard time in our lives, and I was receiving a lot of counsel from a pastor down in the Carlisle area. But Carlisle is kind of far from where we live. And so he said, "Jake, there's a pastor actually somewhat closer. He's out past Sealands Grove. He's still far, but he's closer to you. And so if you're willing to drive and he meets with you, I think he too would be a great benefit to you." So never met this man before in my life, but I go and I have lunch with him. And he begins to ask me, "So what's going on? What are the trials that you're currently experiencing in ministry?" And we have a very good conversation. He offers me a lot of encouragement. But one of the things that he said that I almost knew as soon as he said it that it was something that would stick with me. It was one of those moments. And he was in the middle of praying for me when he said something that I had heard before, but there was something about it that day that just totally changed my worldview. It shifted everything for me. As he was praying about my situation, and he said, "Lord, we know that everything that has happened to Jake and his family has not happened beyond your providential control. You have not been surprised by anything. Nothing has taken you by confusion or by storm. And at no point will you ever be found to arise from your throne and to pace the throne room of heaven wondering what's going to come next. You are sovereignly enthroned. You are seated forevermore. You know the end from the beginning, and you are totally in control." And there was something about it that day. And I know he didn't get this. I know he didn't make this up himself. I know it wasn't original to him. But I'm forever thankful to that man for praying the way he did and offering the encouragement he did that day, because that has stuck with me since. That no matter what we experience, no matter what we go through, it does not take God by surprise. And not only does it not take him by surprise, he's still working to bring all things to a conclusion for our good and his glory. And he's never going to pace the throne room of heaven wondering what to do next. He's already active. He's already moving. And so after that conversation, he gave me a book, which kind of actually went through the same things, But through all of that, one of my favorite verses in the Bible became Habakkuk 2:20. And Habakkuk, the prophet, is complaining to God about all of the evil and injustice and wickedness and wretchedness on the earth. And he's asking God, why haven't you taken care of it yet? Why does this evil persist? And God answers him and says, I'm doing things you can't even begin to see. He says, I'm going to justify the wicked through faith. I'm going to deal with those who will not come to me in faith. The wicked will be judged. I am doing unimaginable things you wouldn't even believe if I told you. And then at the conclusion, after having complained but now coming to this reality, Habakkuk writes in chapter 2, verse 20, but the Lord is in his holy temple. Let all the earth keep silence before him. Where is God? In heaven, sitting upon his throne. And where's the Son? Sovereignly enthroned next to the Father, awaiting all things to be made a footstool beneath his feet. Don't think that he's taken by surprise. He is sovereignly enthroned, seated, and ruling and reigning. And when you come to him, he'll meet your need so you can have peace. Jesus, relying upon his heavenly Father, knew these truths, and so he had peace. But he had peace in an unfathomable way that reveals to us that he is the king in the line and lineage of David. But he's not just the king. Thirdly, we see, what manner of man is this? Jesus is the savior of those who are perishing. He is the savior of those who are perishing. Look at verse 25. They went and they woke him, saying, save us, Lord, we are perishing. First of all, think of how ironic this is. As far as the disciples know at this point, Jesus is a man from Nazareth. Nazareth was a mountainous region. There were no seas of Galilee to be sailing on. As far as they know, he doesn't know anything about boating. He doesn't know anything about the Sea of Galilee. But here you have Galilean fishermen who have been doing this basically their entire lives. And when the storm comes and they think they're going to capsize, they don't appeal to their own knowledge or wisdom. They immediately go to Jesus Christ because they recognize in him a savior who saves the perishing. Perhaps they don't even really know how wonderful of a statement this is. But they recognize somewhere deep down inside that this man saves the perishing. It also points us to the book of Jonah, doesn't it? Same thing happens to Jonah in a similar way, but this account reveals to us that Jesus is the greater Jonah. Jonah was running from God, didn't want to preach in Nineveh. He gets on a boat and God sends a storm. And the sailors awake Jonah in Jonah 1, 5 and 6, and this is what we read. The mariners, they were afraid, and each cried out to his God. And they hurled the cargo that was in the ship into the sea to lighten it for them. But Jonah had gone down into the inner part of the ship and had laid down, and he was fast asleep. So the captain came and said to him, what do you mean, you sleeper? Arise, call out to your God. Perhaps the God will give a thought to us that we may not perish. Now you see similarities there between the two, but you see Jesus is greater than Jonah. Jonah brought that affliction upon the sailors because he refused to humble himself and go and preach to Nineveh. Jesus saves us from our afflictions because he humbles himself to the point of death, even the death of the cross. The sailors awake Jonah and say, pray to your God. But the disciples awake Jesus and they pray directly to him. They already know something that they have not actually begun to recognize yet in their own minds. But deep down they know he's the savior of those who are perishing. Likewise, it reveals again that he's God. Because there's a very similar account in Isaiah 51. In Isaiah 51, 9 and 10, Isaiah writes about awaking the Lord. And this is what he said. Awake, awake, put on strength, O arm of the Lord. Awake as in the days of old, the generations of long ago. Was it not you who cut Rahab in pieces, who pierced the dragon? Was it not you who dried up the sea, the waters of the great deep, who made the depths of the sea a way for the redeemed to pass over? Isaiah's prayer for salvation begins with a prayer that God would awake. Not in the sense that God sleeps. We know Psalm 121:4, that the Lord neither slumbers nor sleeps. Rather, this is just a poetic expression that the Lord would be roused to move on our behalf. And beautifully, when we call upon him, just as the disciples called upon Jesus, God immediately moves on behalf of those whom he loves. But what's interesting in Isaiah's prayer for God to awaken is that it relates all to the sea. How God controlled the sea in the past. How he destroyed this great sea creature, Rahab, which is related somehow, it says, to the dragon. Some people debate, was Rahab real? Was this a real sea creature? Did it exist? Was it a dragon? Was it a dinosaur? Or is it just mythical? Well, it seems that this creature really did exist. It was probably some sort of dinosaur that was huge and massive, like a dragon. And God destroyed it in his power. We read, by the way, the same thing in Psalm 74:12-17. There we read about how God not only controls the seas, but destroys Leviathan in his power. The point of this text, that God controls the seas and destroys the dragon, is to point us all the way back to Genesis 3:15, where we read that a seed will be born to the woman who will crush the head of that old serpent or dragon, the devil. Here you see God accomplishing that. And Jesus' calming of the storm proves he's not only the savior of those who are perishing, but he's going to save those who are perishing by defeating the true dragon, the true serpent, the true deceiver, Satan himself. This is why in Exodus 15:3, we read that the Lord is a man of war. Yahweh is his name. It's why we read in Exodus 14:14 that the Lord, Yahweh, will fight for you. And you need only to hold your peace. When you call upon him, God will act on your behalf and he will save those who are perishing. Now there's comfort to be drawn here, which we see here. Fourthly, because Jesus is the calmer, he is the calmer of winds, seas, and troubled hearts. He is the calmer of wind, seas, and troubled hearts. Look at verse number 26. He said to them, "Why are you afraid, O you of little faith?" Then he rose and he rebuked the winds and the sea, and there was great calm. Here you see all of it unfolding in one passage. Clearly he's God. Clearly he's the Savior. Clearly he's the one to follow. But as you look at this, you might say with Jesus, "Oh, you of little faith," and then you might add to it, "How foolish can you be? You've seen so many signs and wonders. If ever there was a time to be courageous, wouldn't it be when you're with Jesus?" And we look and we say, "If I was there, not me, I wouldn't be afraid. I wouldn't be yelling and frightened. I'd be rebuking the storm myself in the power of Jesus' name." Yeah, sure. Sure you would. The reality is, we're exactly like the disciples. We see great movements of God, and then we become depressed the next day because things didn't quite go our way. We see God do incredible things in our lives, and then we're filled with anxiety when the first sign of trouble comes. We're like Elijah, fighting against the prophets of Baal. We see the great power of God on display. We receive a great victory over 400 prophets at once. And then we're afraid because Jezebel, one lone woman, threatens that she's going to hurt us, that she's going to take our lives. That's who we are. We are a people fearful apart from our God. Now, I'm not saying that fear is a virtue. I'm not saying it's something to extol, something that you should desire. But I am saying that we should recognize it within our own selves. And we should see that, like the disciples, the cure, the remedy for this fear, this anxiety, for our troubled hearts, is Jesus himself. The same Jesus who calms the seas is the same Jesus who calms our beating hearts. And he can do that, by the way, with just a word. As we read in Exodus 33:14, God says to the people, "My presence will go with you, and I will give you rest." And we know that he meant it. He really will give rest to his people. Again, he does it with just a word. Matthew 11:28-30, Jesus says, "Come to me, all you who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light." You need that rest in Christ. If we're going to be the church militant, if we're going to triumphantly march on Christ's behalf through this world, declaring the gospel of the glory of grace in Christ, we need Jesus. We can't do it on our own. We need Christ. Why? Because ultimately we see number five, what I already told you from the get-go. Jesus is the God-man. He's the God-man. As verse 27 says, the men marvel. They see Jesus calm the seas and they go, wait, what sort of man is this? That even the winds and the waves obey him. Now we've already seen, he's the one to follow. He's the king who has perfect peace because he trusts in his Father. He is the savior of those who are perishing. He calms seas and hearts alike. Who is he? He's God. But if you need any more proof, consider Job 38:8-11, where God answers Job and says to him, "Who shut in the sea with doors when it burst out from the womb? When I made clouds its garment and thick darkness its swaddling band, and prescribed limits for the sea, and set bars and doors, and said, 'Thus far shall you come, and no farther, and here shall your proud waves be stayed.'" The disciples are going back to Job 38 and they're thinking, God's the one who created the sea. And Jesus just calmed the storm without praying to the Father. He rebuked it like he rebukes demons. What manner of man is this? Psalm 89:8-10 says, "O Lord God of hosts, who is as mighty as you, O Lord, with your faithfulness all around you? You rule the raging of the sea. When its waves rise, you still them. You crushed Rahab, that old dragon, like a carcass. You scattered your enemies with your mighty arm." The disciples are thinking, Psalm 89, God's the one who stills the raging of the sea. What manner of man is this? Psalm 89:11-12 continues, "The heavens are yours, O God. The earth also is yours. The world and all that is in it, you have founded them. The north and the south, you have created them." And it seems, as they ask the question and all of these verses are rushing into their mind, that God created the sea. And because God created the sea, God controls the sea. And no other can control the sea but God. And Jesus just controlled the sea. They're putting two to two together and they're figuring out, this is God incarnate. This is Jesus Christ, God among us, the Savior of sinners. The question for you this morning is, do you know what manner of man this is? And if you can say he's the God-man, then have you come to him? Have you believed in him? Have you trusted in him to save you from perishing? And if you have trusted in him, are you following him now? Because that's the call for us, isn't it? That no matter where he leads, we must follow. So repent of your sins, follow this Savior, and if you are following him, know it will not always be easy. There will be trials, there will be troubles, but here's the beauty of it. Your God's grace is sufficient to make up for all of your shortcomings, and God will lead you, and he will be with you through it all. My peace I leave you, my peace I give to you. Not as the world gives, give I unto you. Stand with me as we pray together. Father, as we come before you this morning, we thank you for this passage of Scripture. For Lord, in just a few verses, you prove to us beyond all shadow of a doubt that Jesus is God. God among us. God made flesh. God become a man. God who will take away the sins of the world. Lord, if there's any here who have not had their sins dealt with by Christ, I pray that today would be the day of salvation. And for those who do know Jesus in this way, as we see him calming the storm and the waves, Lord, I pray that you would calm any troubled hearts that are here today. Lord, I pray that through the power of your word and the spirit, you would minister to your people here. Give us great boldness, courage, and yet at the same time, peace and rest in Christ to do all that you have called us to do. For your glory alone, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen.
Page 416.
Closer to you. In Jesus' name, amen.